Okay, good evening to online students as well. So this session is basically to give you an idea about how you fill in DAF 1, right? You have two parts of DAF to be filled. Actually speaking, DAF 1 is nothing. It is in DAF 2 the real inputs have to be given, because it is in DAF 2, the second part that you fill after your mains, that is where all your hobby related inputs will be given after mains. This part of the detailed application form that you will be filling in right now, it is just adding more points to whatever you have filled in the prelim stage. Okay, because most of the fields that you will have to fill in here are always already there populated. It is already inputs are given there. So you cannot modify those inputs also. For example, your name, your community, religion, father's name, mother's name, disability status, all that is already filled in. You cannot make changes. See, this is how these are different fields from point number 1 to point 21. There are 21 different inputs that are got from you. Okay, some of them are already filled. So I have given you what that is. Date of birth, you cannot change it. Whether you are claiming age relaxation or not. So if so, you would have claimed it in the prelim stage itself. There is nothing that you will claim it only now. So that's also something that you cannot change. Gender, community, OBC or forward general or EWS, SC, ST, whatever it is, you cannot change. Whatever your caste is. If you are an OBC candidate, whether you are under creamy layer or not, these are all areas that you have no control over as of now. It is already filled. Okay. Your category of disability, percentage of disability, and which exam center would you like to choose? All that is already given. So I don't think I need to explain anything here, because there is no point in doing it. Anyways, you cannot change it. Okay. So there are certain areas like these which are already filled in. Okay, so what is in your control? What can you do? Point number 2, address for correspondence. I'll just walk you through it first. You just listen. If you have any doubts about these, you can ask me. Okay, instead of noting it down, because once you see the DAF portal on UPSC, you would automatically start filling it easily. There isn't anything that is actually challenging in the first place. So we have a lot of inputs that we need to fill in. Address for correspondence. Normal data. So wherever you are temporarily residing, wherever you would want the messages from UPSC to come and reach you. Okay. So where you know that UPSC can communicate with you, that should be the address. It can be your room address or your permanent home address as per your convenience. So give all that here. And then apart from that, you also have what is called as the permanent address. So permanent address, fill in. I'm sure you will be having your home. So you can fill that, because it is from there questions can be asked. You know, temporary address usually does, UPSC doesn't ask questions. But permanent address, make sure you fill in about the area where you actually, for example, you might have stayed for 15 years in a place. Okay. You might have your ancestral home there, but your father might be transferred to some other place where only for the last 1 year you have been residing. Your father might have even bought a new house also there in the new place. But it doesn't mean that you have to give the present address of your father as your permanent address. You can have the choice, whichever you feel is something where I can prepare adequately, you know, where I can really, I have a good idea about. So give that as your permanent address. Okay. Postal office, city, district, pin code, everything. Community details. What is that you can fill in? Already your community has been captured by UPSC while your prelim stage, whether you are general or not, and your caste name, everything is captured. And you would have been given a cutoff date by which you should have got your prelims time, you should have got your caste certificate also, right? When the prelims notification was issued, they would have given a cutoff date also for that. Yes? So I don't think you're going to get a new community certificate anymore, right? Already you have got a community certificate. Based on that only, you have given your community status as such. Now all that you need to do is enter the number, caste certificate, it has a number, date of issue, whatever is the date. You see the community certificate and you will have it. General category, nothing, no. Designation of issuing authority should be Tehsildar and above rank. Most probably it will be a Tehsildar who would be issuing it. And the entire address of the Tehsil office. Tehsildar, which Tehsil, which district, entire address will be there. Yeah. You have to fill it everything and finally say, I belong to creamy layer. So you have to fill it in. Then disability details. So yeah, disability details, I only add D and E for those people who might have some physical challenges. For those, some columns are already filled in by your prelim stage itself, whether you are disabled or not, what kind of disability you have, and what is the percentage, whether do you have it above a certain benchmark of 40% or not. All those details have been already captured. Column 9 is about disability status. As an addition to this, now what you will have to fill in, similarly, community also, category 8, point number 8, you have already filled in a lot of details. Community, name of the caste, creamy layer, minority or not, whether you belong to religious minority or not, whether you're creamy layer or not, all that you have filled in earlier. You cannot change that. Now all that you can do is just give some documentary proof in the form of what is the certificate number, authority and all that, right? Similarly for disabled, you have to give your certificate number. The certificate should have been given by the correct level of authority, okay? I'm sure people would have already got your certificates already in your hand. The correct authority is basically the level of a civil surgeon or a chief medical officer at a medical superintendent at a district level, right? With his signature, with his authority, under his authority, you should have got a disability certificate. There is a proper prescribed pro forma. There is a format for that, which is also given in the rules itself. Okay, tomorrow when your, has your portal been opened for registration? Not yet. DAF one. Once it is open, once you open it, you will have the link to all the rules. Okay, when you click, you'll also have the link to different formats also. For OBC, you have to get the form in a prescribed manner. Okay, so all that will be there. I'm sure you would have already got that long back. You would have already got those forms and everything. And anyway, your tehsildar would have given the certificate in that format only. Similarly, your medical superintendent also would have given the certificate earlier in that same prescribed format. Would not be a divergence in any manner. Okay, what is the number? What is the date in which it will be issued? Designation, chief medical officer, so-and-so district. All that must be clearly entered. Okay, would you require scribe in the examination? To require a scribe, for that also, the medical officer must give it under his authority that he is a person who has this particular disease. Because of this disease, the person cannot write the exam on his own. So he requires a scribe. Okay. So just because you have a hearing disability doesn't mean that you cannot write the exam. You can write. So unless it is certified, for example, you have cerebral palsy or you have Parkinson's disease or you have complete blindness. You know, in those kind of circumstances, you can be offered a help of a scribe. And there are some qualifications. Scribe, you have persons with a disability, either you can choose your own scribe or you can ask UPSC to give their own scribe. Okay, and when you choose your own scribe, some conditions are there. The condition is that the person must be above matriculation level educated. Okay, so such conditions are there. Basically, to avail the services of a scribe, you must get the certification of the medical officer that you are in a position not to write your exam yourself. That is the condition for physically challenged students. Okay. Chief medical officer, civil surgeon, superintendent of a government healthcare institution. There is a proper form and everything. It has to be filled and you have to get it. You have to send the form to the UPSC. Only if UPSC will accept it, they will allot the scribe of your choice. Okay. If yes, commission scribe or own scribe, you have to mention it here. Would you require any assistive devices? So there are devices for reading the question paper, feeling and magnifying the question paper. So would you want such kind of devices, assistance or not? That is what is asked. So we have some choices. These are all for students with physical disabilities. So you can fill in all these kind of details. Okay. The idea here is whether you need a scribe or not, it is to be decided based on your fitness. If you are unfit, if you cannot write on your own as certified by the medical authority, you will be given the assistance of a scribe. That's all. Yeah. For physically challenged students, two things you can note down here. For those with hearing disability, you are exempted from appearing in compulsory language paper. Okay. Those with hearing problems, you don't actually, if you have above the benchmark level of disability, you don't have to appear in the language paper. For students with blindness, you have this option. So large font question paper can be given to you. Okay. So these are the special privileges that you enjoy, aids that you can get from UPSC as a support. Okay. Next, these are the columns that you will have to fill. See, when it comes to language, already you would have chosen the language for SA and GS papers. You would have already chosen it during prelims. You cannot change that. You would have already given the language for your optional papers. You cannot change that. What you can give as of now is the language for interview. Okay, what would be the medium for attending the interview? Okay, whether it could be in English or it could be in Hindi or it can be in the compulsory language paper. Whatever you write in as a compulsory language paper, that could be the option that you can prefer. So out of the three, you can choose anything. And for students who are exempted from appearing in compulsory language paper, do you know some students are exempted from appearing? Who are they? Yeah, from certain Northeast states, they are exempted from appearing in the language papers. Hearing disabled students, they are exempted from appearing in language papers. So for you, the option is either English or in Hindi. Okay, if you want to. For general community, okay. I'm just coming to your questions. After some time, we can take your questions forward. So these are all details that you must fill. Name of your father, name of your mother, nationality of father, nationality, father's profession, mother's profession. All these here regarding your parental occupation and parental details, right? So fill it carefully. I'm sure you will not have any problem with name, nationality and profession. So profession, if your parents have retired, then mark as retired government servant. Or you can say retired central government employee. Retired state government employee. Be very specific, clearly in that. Okay. So if your father is in service, so if your father is presently in service, write it here. If retired, indicate the post held by him at the time of his retirement. Okay. These are also simple. Same with respect to your mother also. And state to which your father belongs, district to which your father originally belongs. See, nobody is going to come and UPSC is not going to check all these details. Okay, you can fill in whatever details you want. But the problem is don't fill some 2, 3, 4 random districts. Your mother is from original district. See, state to which your father originally belongs. You put something here which you have not even visited, which you don't have any idea about. Okay, nobody is going to come and check all these details. Okay, so don't, if you are not very comfortable with those areas. For example, you might be from Bihar, but you might be settled in Delhi because your father has been working in Delhi for a long time. Even your father has lost his touch with Bihar. Okay, no contact at all with Bihar. If such kind of situations are there, it is better to just put it as Delhi and go, because you are anyway going to be well prepared with Delhi, right? Because the more and more data you put in here, the only problem is you have to ensure that you are very good with preparation of all these data. It is from here UPSC will ask questions in the personality test. So be careful about it, right? That's all. If you want to put where your father originally belongs to, you can even put it there. Put there. But the only problem is, what if a member knows about the place and you don't know about the place? Correct? It can probably happen. So just put it whatever you want to mention it here. There is no proof or anything that is required for this purpose. Father's present postal address, wherever he is living. Okay. So fill in. I don't think there is any problem here. So this is for EWS, Economic Weaker Section. So to justify that you are EWS, you have to just declare yes or no here. Okay. So mention it here. This is for EWS. If you are already availing EWS reservation, you will be most probably putting it here as no. You cannot put it as yes. Right? Yeah. That's why, see, DAF 1, nothing to be discussed basically. No hobby part, extracurricular, sports achievements, nothing is there in DAF 1. DAF 1 is, after all, uploading documents for whatever you have already given in prelims. Okay. So do you process the prescribed educational qualification? If so, so this is actually one of the students. So don't worry about it. You have to just fill in your degree certificate number, who is the issuing authority and when it was issued. Write it here. So yeah, process the prescribed educational qualification. That is your UG degree. Or you can even, if you have done your master's, you can even attach your master's degree. One degree's details must be uploaded here. Either it could be your UG or your PG. Whatever you choose to upload here. Okay. Have you ever been employed? This is not about private sector employment. This is about public sector. If you are already working in government, yes. If you are already in government or public enterprise, have you intimated your head of the office? Okay, because some of the government servants, they may have their disciplinary proceedings pending in their office, right? Despite that, they will be appearing for IAS examination. So if a vigilance inquiry is already pending, they cannot, the head of the department will not allow them to write other exams. So it is just to ensure that UPSC is getting a confirmation from you that whether you have intimated to your boss, to your head of the office or not. So you should have already intimated it. Before your prelims itself, you should have intimated that you're appearing for civil service examination if you're already working in a public sector employment. Right. Okay.
Can you intimate?
So you have not intimated it earlier?
I did in last year, but last year.
That is okay. So it is not about whether you are appearing in civil service exam a particular year. Yeah, you can intimate. See, you can intimate. The only thing is you are going to give your own undertaking that I am appearing and I have intimated by head of the department. They are not going to come and check with your office or anything. Okay. But yeah, you can just intimate it. But as per the document, you're supposed to have intimated it in your prelims time itself. That's okay. Just intimate it right now. Have you been self-employed? If you're not working in government, this is another data that UPSC is interested in capturing from you. Are you doing any business or have you found your own employment? That's something. Have you ever been debarred from UPSC from any of its exams? Okay. So all these are simple details. Give no, go, move on. Whether you have applied for UPSC examination recruitment. So the answer would be yes or no, depending upon your previous attempts. But regarding this, already a column is filled. Okay, pre-populated, previous attempts. Field number 18. One of those is previous attempts at UPSC. I think you would have already filled it during your prelims itself. That is populated. Now you cannot change it, 3 attempts or 4 attempts. Okay. So here also they are asking one more details. Whether you have applied. That is about have you appeared in previous exams. This is about have you ever applied earlier or not. So you can just give yes or no. And based on the exam, have you ever accepted the allocation to a service or post? So the answer probably will be no. Okay, if you have already been allotted Railway Protection Force and you are not interested to go and prefer that to work in RPF. So you can say no. Even though I have applied, even though I have appeared in the exam, even though I have been allotted, yes, but I have not accepted the allocation, right? So possibly, all these are factual data, just give your inputs. Which civil service exam were you allotted the service or post? It could even be CAPF also. It could even be, because all these exams are conducted by UPSC, CAPF examination, right? And geologist exams, forest service exam. So in any of this, if you would have been allotted, you have to mention it. Name of the service or post. So once who have to fill in yes here will not even be attending the session first of all. Right? Because they have already filled in DAF and everything. So most probably not. So name of the service and what is your roll number in that particular exam that you have appeared. It's all simple details. It is mostly you will be giving no here. Whether you are continuing the service or post. All that is regarding UPSC. Okay, if you have been allotted a particular post under UPSC and whether are you still continuing in it or not, or have you resigned it or not, so those details. It is not about other government services. It is about whether under UPSC exam, have you been awarded any service allocation in the past. That is it. Fee payment details. All this you have to enter in here. Okay, so I think this is also populated. I'm not very sure. You don't have to pay any fees for mains. Whatever you have paid earlier, that is the fees. I think it might also be populated. I'm not very sure, but I don't think you have to enter it once again regarding all these transaction ID and all that. I think it will come automatically. Okay. The most important things are what documents you have to keep in your hand to upload. Okay. One is regarding your education. Education proof. So what is the proof for education? It is UG, your graduation certificate. Okay, that is one document that you will have to scan and upload. The next document that you will have to upload is your identity card. Okay, Aadhaar, passport, driving license. You have to have that so as to scan and upload. Okay, the other ID is regarding your date of birth. And what is the document? Document is your matriculation certificate. It is not your 12th standard certificate or anything. Okay, UPSC is very specific about it. You have to upload the matriculation certificate for this purpose. Okay, or any other equivalent certificate. Equivalent means SSLC certificate, secondary school leaving certificate. You might be in CBSE, so SSLC certificate you have to upload. That is your date of birth proof, right? And if you're availing relaxation in your number of attempts, for example, if you're a PWD candidate, even though you may be in general category, you will be given 9 attempts totally. You will have 3 hours of relaxation applicable for PWD candidates. For OBC also, see, beyond 32 years, if you are applying, it means that you are availing relaxation in your age limit. So in that case, you will have to upload your these certificates. That's all. So if you are from Northeast, prove that you are from Northeast to get exemption from the language papers. So you have to get a something called as hailing certificate. The format is also given in UPSC itself. There is a form, you have to fill it in, get the signature of your subdivisional officer or your assistant commissioner, whatever designation he might be called in your respective state. Get a signature and you can be exempted from your language paper. Yeah. For hard of hearing disabled candidates, if you have been already given an exemption in your school days, okay, as per your university, granted such exemption from second and third language courses by concerned education board. For example, from Tamil Nadu. In Tamil Nadu, the education department has given you an exemption in 10th and 11th and 10th exam and 12th exam. You have been exempted from the language paper. Okay, if that is the case, you don't actually have to write, you don't have to appear in the language paper in UPSC. Okay, so you should have been exempted by your school board. For example, you might have studied completely in Tamil. Okay, and you might not know anything about English. Okay, for hearing disabled students, that could be the situation of education in that particular state. So special education in that state might have been given completely in Tamil. So the person might not have any idea about English. If that is the case, you're exempted completely from English. Okay, so that is another document you have to prove so as to get exempted from the language paper. And I told you, educational qualification, this is the undertaking that you must be concerned about. Okay, undertaking for government employees. So this is just a self undertaking. You don't have to get the officer's signature or anything. You declare yourself. Copy of the selected photo ID proof, voter card, PAN card, passport, driving license and Aadhaar card. Any of these. Okay. So that's all about DAF 1. Probably within a week, the window will open. And UPSC will give you two weeks of time. 15 days will be there. So just check as soon as we will notify it to you. You are there in the groups. So we'll be notifying it to you about the window. So as soon as it opens, just fill it in. Okay. There's nothing new to be filled except for your parental details. That is the area where you'll have to think and you'll have to fill in some details. Apart from that, everything else is whatever you have already filled. You have to just upload the documents. Okay. DAF 1 is quite simple. There isn't anything much to be concerned about DAF 1. It is only in DAF 2 we'll have more discussions on what all you need to be filling in. Okay, doubts. For graduation certificate, is provisional certificate enough or final degree is needed? Final degree is needed by now. Okay, provisional is acceptable for your prelims. But by the time you give your mains, by then your final degree is required. So I'm sure your final degree would have been given by now. Not yet given. Okay. Right. Maybe because of the pandemic, it could be delayed. So I think in that case, do you have a certificate number in your provisional certificate? No, you will be given a provisional certificate. Okay. No. I got my provisional from the college as soon as convocation was over. You have not got it? No? It has a number, right. Okay. Regarding occupation, I worked as a doctor in private hospital for 3 months. Should I mention it self-employment or anywhere? No. See, you will have a totally different column in DAF 2 where you will be filling in your occupational details and everything. Okay, so this is not the place to mention it. That is in DAF 2. At that time, you can bring in your work experience, how many years you are working, what is the salary that you are receiving, all that you'll be mentioning it in the DAF 2. Here, it will not be there. Okay. Parents are not there, no more means what can I fill? Just write it deceased. Okay, deceased. D-E-C-E-A-S-E-D. And put their salaries as 00. You can fill in the other details. Are you there? So definitely there will not be a present address of your parents. So just leave the column blank. Okay, you don't have to fill in anything there. Sir, I am an English medium student who 10th written Tamil, in 11th and 12th taken French. Will there be any relaxation in Tamil language? Yeah, you can write Hindi if you want. One of the papers, language should be one among the Indian languages. That is the criteria. Okay, it can be anything out of the Indian languages, the different scheduled languages. So you cannot write a language paper in French. That cannot be done. Can I change exam center? No, you cannot change the exam center. It's what you have already given. There is no change of exam center that is allowed. Current studying course LLB need not be mentioned in degree, right? Yeah, you cannot mention it because you have not yet got the degree. Okay, it's only if you have the degree in, I believe you are talking about post graduation. You may be pursuing law as a post graduate, a doctor, Venkatesh Prasad. So you are already a doctor and you're pursuing post graduation in law. Just fill in your UG alone. Okay, you cannot, you will never be able to bring it in any other area, even in DAF 2 also. It is only if you have graduated, you will be able to mention it. So you are only an MBBS doctor, you can only mention about it. I have applied for 2020 prelims and withdrew it during lockdown. What should be my response to the questions? Have you applied? Well, I don't think you can. You need to write. Have you applied? Yeah, you should write as you have applied. Yes, you should write it as if you have applied only. Okay, even though you might have withdrawn the application, but you have applied. So you should write, yes, you have applied, but that will not be counted as an attempt. So OBC creamy layer certificate has only 1 year validity till March 2021. Should I get apply for another certificate or use the old one? March 2021. Yeah, so that's all. You don't have to apply for any new certificate. This is a certificate for the financial year 2020 to 2021. Correct? That is the certificate that you're supposed to be using for this exam. So you don't have to get any new certificate. You have to get a new certificate for the next year's attempt, not for this attempt. Whatever you have applied with earlier for the financial year 2020 to 2021, whatever certificate that you have, that is the correct certificate. Is it correct? You would have got only for the last financial year, right? Okay. Can't understand between previously applied and previous attempts. What is that? You would have applied, but you would not have appeared on the day of the exam. That is the difference. Whether you have appeared on the day of the exam or not, it gets counted as a appeared attempt.
That rule changed in 2009. Whether you appear or not, it is counted as an attempt.
No.
In 1999.
Sir, I have also read the rule. Even if you present my name on the exam, it's counted as an attempt.
It will not. அப்படி இருக்கா என்ன? அப்படிலாம் படிச்ச மாதிரிலாம் இருக்காது. ஃபார் எக்ஸாம்பிள் ஐ அப்ளை, ஐ ஹாவ் ஃபீவர் ஆன் த டே, கேன் வில் இட் பி கவுண்டட் அஸ் அன் அட்டெம்ப்ட்? யூபிஎஸ்சி ஹட் கிவன் ஃப்ரம் 2019 அன் ஆப்ஷன் டு வித்ட்ரா யர் அப்ளிகேஷன். தட் இஸ் ஃபார் யூபிஎஸ்சிஸ் அட்மினிஸ்ட்ரேட்டிவ் பெட்டர்மெண்ட். ஸோ தட் தே கேன் கிளியர்லி நோ ஹவு மெனி ஃபெசிலிட்டிஸ் தே மஸ்ட் பி கிரியேட்டிங் அண்ட் ஆல் தட். ஓகே, ஜஸ்ட் பிகாஸ் யூ ஹவ் அப்ளைட் இட் டசன்ட், இட் இல் நெவர் பி கவுண்டட் அஸ் அ அட்டெம்ப்ட். இஃப் அ பர்சன் சேஞ்ச் இஸ் நேம் இன் லாஸ்ட் இயர் பட் இன் திஸ் கிராஜுவேஷன் சர்டிஃபிகேட் ஹி ஹவ் நியூ நேம் அண்ட் இஸ் KM Pradeep, okay. Is it really your condition or are you hypothesizing, imagining that if something has happened, or is it your condition right now? Is OBC certificate which is received online valid? Okay. I heard many saying only offline certificate is valid. It doesn't mean, see, there's nothing called as offline certificate. Okay. Everything is digitized in a digitized format. Printout is taken. That's all. Okay. Because your signature of the tehsildar is also a digital signature certificate. So there is nothing called as an online certificate and an offline certificate. Okay, it is just one certificate. So online, if it has a digital signature of tehsildar, that is perfectly valid. Yeah. If a person changed his name in last year, but in his graduation certificate, he has new name. And a school certificate, he has old name. And also he has all proof of gazette. How was the process for UPSC? Different whether he want to put his old name or new name. You have to just put your new name, okay, and you have to show the gazette change. That document proof has to be submitted to the UPSC when they ask later for verification. Okay, now you don't have to upload anything of that sort. You just proceed with the same data with your old name in your school certificate, upload it. UPSC will ask for clarification. The names are changing, so what happened? Then you give your explanation that because I went underwent a name change. And these are the gazette notifications. So can they please share required documents in Telegram group once? And there is a need of income certificate. Income certificate, no. These are the documents which I have just copy pasted from the rules. Okay, so you don't require income certificate. That is actually a part of your certification already given by Tehsildar. When Tehsildar gives a OBC non-creamy layer certificate, it already means that he has taken the income into account. So Taniya, separately, you don't need an income certificate or anything. That need not be uploaded. Only these documents have to be uploaded. Income certificate and all, there's nothing. I know there is an income certificate, but that need not be uploaded here because you are anyway, your income is verified by the Tehsildar. Can we get the OBC certificate now? I have not gotten before prelims. I don't think that is acceptable. Okay, UPSC is very clear when it said you should have got a OBC certificate before prelims itself. Okay, you should have been an OBC in the last financial year. Okay, so that I think UPSC is very strict about it. You cannot get a OBC certificate right now. Okay, it will not be accepted. So you would only be treated as a general category candidate. Okay, so if you should be clearing all the three phases in general category. Should we upload EWS certificate? Yes, you must upload EWS certificate as well. You must upload it. Maybe I have forgotten to mention it here, but yeah, you have to upload it. Yes. Nothing. No relaxation. Same. You will be treated the same. I come under general due to creamy layer, whether OBC certificate is needed. Yes, you must get your certificate. If you're a creamy layer, you don't actually have to get any certificate. You will just declare OBC, but still I'm in a creamy layer and that's all. You will not get any certificate for that. Can I opt for scribe? Because, okay, since I can't write, is there any procedure for it? Yes, you can. If your doctor, a medical superintendent in a district level hospital, okay, a district hospital, you have the chief medical officer there, he will have to give a certificate. That format is also there in the rules itself. Okay, it's a clear format. I think you would already be aware of the format. So, fill in all the details and the doctor must certify that because of your accident, you will not be able to handle the exam. So, yes, it is very much possible. Only if your benchmark, your disability is beyond that benchmark of 40%. And doctor certification is also necessary that you cannot, for example, your left hand might be deformed. So you can get the benefit of PWD, but you will be perfectly well to write your exam on your own, right? So the doctor certificate is the vital aspect here. So if your doctor certifies examining your condition, you can avail a scribe. That's all. Okay. In my name, I have RC for one company, for third partner. It was running by my father in my name. That company name was registered, whether I want put I'm earning person or unemployed person. For one company, for third partner, that was running by my father in my name. So it is basically, it's a business run in your name. Okay, the company is registered. Okay, whether I want to put I'm earning person or unemployed. You should write as I am self-employed. Okay. You are running the business. You must write it as you are self-employed. Sir, I have a BC certificate, which I got long back in school days. That is all not accepted. Okay. Your state government given backward class certificate is different. Creamy, non-creamy layer certificate is different. So your state certificate is not at all valid for UPSC examination. You should have got it before your prelims itself. Right now, UPSC will definitely not accept it. So I know of candidature which has been rejected because of these grounds. Okay, so you should have been much more watchful and careful before your prelims itself. Should we get, anyway, if the father is no more, is it enough to use deceased for his details? Yes, if your father is no more, just give deceased as his details. Write your father's name, deceased, that's all. So income will be zero, okay? And the present address, blank. That is how the form will be. All right. So I think we are done. There's nothing much to be discussed here. So do your mains well, and we will discuss for DAF 2. Okay, at that time more caution will have to be exercised. We'll do that. So I believe all of you will do well, prepare well. Since you have just come, I'm sure all of your attempts are first attempt, the best possible attempt to get into the examination. Okay, never ever assume as a first attempter, I'm at a disadvantage compared to veterans. UPSC is ensuring the examination goes in such a way that everybody has a level playing ground. I'm sure you would have felt it in the prelims itself, right? Similarly, in mains also, that is the same. You are at the same level as that of everybody else, except for your optional papers. Make optional preparation more stronger. Okay, and you will end up studying 14-15 hours per day from now onwards. Compartmentalize, make a proper plan. You have 90 more days. I'll tell you what had worked for me. 90 days, all I did was I broke the syllabus sheet into small parts. Break the syllabus sheet into each part. Take each word. Make sure you have some 5-6 pages of good content for that. Content that is not repetitive. What I'm saying is the content that you prepare now must be different from all previous year's questions. I'm not saying you should not look at previous year question. Have a look at the previous year question. Understand the trend of UPSC. Think more about how else can UPSC ask questions. And try to think on current affairs that has happened in the last 1.5 years. From this current affairs seem to be related to this particular topic. So UPSC has been asking questions in this direction. So what more can UPSC ask? To know what more test series, many other test series, many other questions that you find randomly, keep on thinking on them. That is the way you will come with diverse topics to prepare for. Okay, prepare as many areas as possible. That's what I say. For each and every word in the syllabus sheet, make sure you have some 4 or 5 pages of content. That is the only work. Okay, GS1, 2, 3, 4, each and every part of syllabus sheet must have 3-4 pages of content. Different content from previous year's questions, because previous year's questions never repeat in UPSC. Areas might repeat, but the same question will never, ever, ever repeat, right? Just keep this as a target. So I have 80, 90 days. How many days do you have? Only 68 days. Okay. 68 days. 5 hours should be gone on optional preparation. Weekly, one Sunday completely gone on ethics and essay preparation. So remaining 6 days every day, assuming then you have 10 hours of time. Okay. And always keep in touch with the newspaper. Don't avoid newspaper. It helps you in revising current affairs. Okay. So 1 hour of newspaper preparation, keep doing it. 5 minutes on that. Keep preparing. 1 hour of newspaper reading and 10 hours of GS preparation. Okay. 5 hours, 6 hours of optional, 8 to 9 hours of GS preparation and 1 hour of newspaper. That's all. That is your routine. And remaining time, sleep. Okay. So this 3 months is where the best of the preparation will actually happen. If you utilize 15 to 16 hours every day for your preparation, because you're running short of time. Okay. So do it weekly once, come here, write a test. Experiment what you have already learned is suitable to get you marks or not. So as soon as the test is written, now think, what more could I have written? What could have been the value addition to these questions? Value additions cannot be done if you're in your first attempt, it cannot be done before your test. Face the test, face the question, you will be knowing your weaker areas where you will be without any points or statistics to substantiate your answer. Immediately after the test, go browse and keep building value addition statistics and data. Okay, now learn how to use them in the next tests. Okay, so that is the way how you go about with your preparation. And if you have any other doubts, you can always drop a mail to me, okay, regarding your study materials or any other queries about, or maybe to have a feedback. If you're offline, you can just come here, you can meet me and you can show me your papers. I can also suggest you some corrections. I'm sure you have my mail ID with you all. Okay. It's just SAKTHYAKRISHNAN@shankarias.in. Okay, shankarias.in. So this is my mail ID. SAKTHYAKRISHNAN. And if you any doubts, just mention in the mail that you are going to write this mains. Okay, you will get an immediate reply also. Okay. All right. Okay, general doubt, not my case. Unfortunately, someone broken his hand and undergoing medical treatment. Scribe can be availed. Yes, it can be availed. In the medical certificate, the doctor has an option. Whether the condition is temporary, whether it will improve or not, all that can be mentioned. So, you can get a scribe also that way. So, fine. Thank you. And have a good Diwali. All the best for your preparation. Many, many sources. Browsing randomly from many sources, good websites like wire.com, LiveMint, PRS. Many. There is no limit on where you can browse. ORF for international relations, IDSA for international relations. Anything. Your preparation must know, you must know that, okay, I'm focusing on trade aspect of Indo-China relationship. Now start browsing about it. That is the way. Every website that you can use can be a source builder. Okay. All right. Thank you. All the best. Thank you.